Everybody get up on your feet. Let's sing this together. Come on, y'all. Right here. Everyone sing.
Good morning, my fellow brothers and sisters. Good morning to each and every one of you, and may God richly bless each and every one of you. Let us get started this morning with the Victory Baptist Morning Worship Service. For our devotion this morning, I'm looking at James, the second chapter, verses 14 through 17. What good is it, my brothers and sisters, if someone claims to have faith but has no deeds? Can such faith save them? Suppose a brother or a sister without faith comes to your daily food. If one of you say to them, go in peace, keep warm and well fed, but does nothing about their physical need, what good is it? In the same way, faith by itself is not accompanied by action, is dead. May the Lord bless the reading and hearing of his holy word. Please join me, if you will, in a word of prayer. Our most loving Father, our Father in heaven, Lord, thank you this morning. Thank you for blessing us. Thank you for providing for us, Heavenly Father. We love you, Heavenly Father, and we just thank you. And we thank you for teaching us to be lovers like you are, Heavenly Father, that we love each and every one. Heavenly Father, we thank you for teaching us to be forgiving. Heavenly Father, we just thank you for sending us out as disciples, true to your word. Heavenly Father, we thank you. And we thank you for our pastor, our pastor's family, each and every member and each and every member's family, Heavenly Father. We thank you for every individual, Heavenly Father. We lift everyone up that they will continue in good health. Heavenly Father, those that are ill, we lift them up that you will touch their bodies and promote healing. And Heavenly Father, those that are bereaved, we ask that you touch their hearts and minds, Heavenly Father, and give them the comfort. And Lord, we thank you for sending people of knowledge and willingness to work with us in rebuilding our church. And we ask that you bless that whole process, Heavenly Father. We continue to lift up each and every member of political organizations, Heavenly Father, that you will give us the right leadership, give us the right guidance. Heavenly Father, show them what you need, what you want done, Heavenly Father, for your people, all people, Heavenly Father. We thank you, and we just lift up this service in your name. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
So many wonderful things about Jesus. There are so many wonderful things about him. There's so many wonderful things about Jesus. There are so many wonderful things about him. So many wonderful things about Jesus. There are so many wonderful things about him. His name is wonderful. He's a wonderful counselor. And there's so many wonderful things about him. His name is wonderful. He's a wonderful counselor. And there's so many wonderful things about him. There's so many wonderful things about Jesus. There are so many wonderful things about him. So many wonderful things about Jesus. There are so many wonderful things about him. His name is wonderful. He's a wonderful counselor. He is a mighty God, everlasting Father. He is a Prince of Peace. And there's so many wonderful things about him. His name is wonderful. He's a wonderful counselor. He is a wonderful. He's a wonderful counselor. He is a Prince of Peace. So many wonderful things about him. His name is wonderful. His name is wonderful. His name is wonderful. He's a wonderful counselor. He's a wonderful counselor. He is a mighty God. He is a mighty God, the everlasting counselor, and there's so many wonderful things about him.
morning, Victory Baptist Church and friends and neighbors who support and listen to this broadcast on every Sunday. My name is Pastor Jenkins, and I've been preaching to you since our church every Sunday, since we suffered the tragic loss of the arson of our place of worship. But we still must continue on, must carry on in life, must carry on. Pick up the pieces, stay in the ship, and finish the journey or the task. We would like to call and or recall the passage that we preached about last week. We didn't finish the entire segment from verse 13 through 18 of 1 Thessalonians, the fourth chapter. 1 Thessalonians, the fourth chapter, and the 13th through the 18th verse. So we're going to do a little repeating of last week's message and then wrap it up with the additional chapters. So use the same scripture and just try to finish that scripture up. On verse 13, chapter 4, 1 Thessalonians. Brothers and sisters, we do not want you to be uninformed. Another word used often is ignorant about those who sleep in death, so that you do not grieve like the rest of mankind who have no hope. For we believe that Jesus died and rose again, and so we believe that God will bring with Jesus those who have fallen asleep in him. According to the Lord's word, we tell you that we who are still here or alive, who are left until the coming of the Lord, will certainly not precede those who have fallen asleep. For the Lord himself will come down from heaven with a loud command, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trumpet call of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. After that, we who are still alive and are left will be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And so we will be with the Lord forever. Therefore, encourage one another with these words. Our emphasis scriptures will be verse 15 through 18. May the Lord add a blessing to the reading and to the hearers of his word. We're going to talk with you this morning briefly on that great family reunion. The great family reunion. As a brief overview, we look at 13. This is written by Paul and Timothy. And this is probably about 20 to 30 years after the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. So it wasn't long after Christ rose from the dead. So then Paul speaks to a group of believers that are struggling with this idea of death. That's one area that they are struggling with, the death of loved ones and their destiny. So he says, I don't want you to be ignorant and uninformed and not know about those who sleep in death, people who go on. Don't get hung up on that. And don't grieve like the rest of many people, mankind, who have no hope. There was a belief system among people that they were not even clear of what happened to a loved one after they died. So Paul says, for we believe that Jesus died and he rose again. And so we believe that God will bring with Jesus those who have fallen asleep. This was a hopeless community in this area of theology. They just didn't know. They were concerned. And they started to take on some of the practices of other nations that were very ignorant or lacked a great deal of knowledge about the life hereafter. The hopelessness was prominent in the pagan world. They had no idea, or the ideas that they arrived at about the death of loved ones was rather ancient, and it was not current to the thought that the truth that Jesus would provide was not evident in their theology. They just didn't know. And people tend to develop their views based on the family unit. If mama and papa don't know, and grandma and grandma don't know, then oftentimes the children don't know. So this was a group of people that's getting this letter that just didn't know what to expect about the death of loved ones who would go before them. It was hopeless in the world. They had no clue. So that caused a great deal of stress to those who were concerned. What they didn't know is that there would be a family reunion. There would be a time when Jesus would return and the dead in Christ would rise, and those who remain would be caught up to meet him in the air. They had no idea. There were some that had an idea, but the general population was somewhat clueless. Paul is suggesting very strongly to them to place this deep sorrow aside, this in the present tense, continuing sorrow. Just imagine that, if you will, being in continuing sorrow, day in and day out, worried, perplexed about the destiny of loved ones. And of course, it would spill off into your concerns about death. What would happen to you when you died? So this death was something ongoing, or these feelings of death were ongoing. It was continuous. And so Paul writes this letter to provide some relief. And anything bothers you day in and day out, and it must have been something serious, that it can have a tremendous effect on you, on your life, socially, theologically, and in many other ways. So it's best to learn the truth. And Paul is providing some insights as to the destiny of those who died before those who remain, and that if it applies to others, it applies to us as well. So if the Lord is we're going to be present with the Lord, we're going to have hope for the dead, then we can surely have hope for those who are alive. Verse 14 reminds us, for if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, of course we should believe that God will bring with Jesus those who have fallen asleep in him. Now, verse 14, there's some issues that kind of puzzled me up a little bit last week, but I thought I'd come back to it and look at it from another direction on verse 14. verse 14 says, "For we believe that Jesus died and rose again." Now that kind of puzzled me, because if we already believe that, then why was it necessary to write about it? Or why would you say "we believe" when there appears to be a question of lack of knowledge about the resurrection or the destination of loved ones? The other area that was somewhat puzzling to me was God will bring with Jesus. It appeared to me that the Lord would come back, and he would call those who are still here up to meet him in the air, those who are dead to rise. So I think in verse 14, "we believe," I think it's a general statement, but after it somewhat being explained of what will happen after death, "we believe Jesus died and rose again, and we're told not to grieve as those that have no hope." And there probably was a significant group of people that had insights on death. Oftentimes we say, "Well, we believe that the Lord will come in church." We say that, or we say, "We believe that God is on the throne." Well, now everybody in that congregation might not believe that God is on his throne, but we can say it generally speaking, with the understanding futuristically that those who don't know now will know later. So we can comfortably say "we believe" without it being totally inclusive of everyone who would read this passage or hear it. "We believe." And then "God will bring with Jesus." What does that say here in the scripture here? That's in verse 14. "So we believe that God will bring with Jesus those who have fallen asleep in him." That passage kind of puzzled me, that God will bring with Jesus. And I wonder if that was a mistranslation or if it was a copyist error. "We believe that God will bring with Jesus those who have fallen asleep in him." God will bring. Sounds like that God is bringing Jesus God and Jesus are joining together to bring back those who are still here, those who have fallen asleep in him. Jesus died and rose again, so we believe that God will bring with Jesus those who have fallen. And I mentioned last week, I looked at various commentaries to see what different people were saying, and they definitely had different views. Now, my view on this is that I would use what I feel is a better word. I would say that God will bring through Jesus those who have fallen asleep in him. So Jesus is used as an instrument for this revival of the souls and those who have passed on. Other people have other views, but that's the way that it seems. It would be better understood. It's easier to understand by me that God will bring through Jesus. Although there's much disagreement, but that translation sounds most comfortable to me, that when Jesus comes to get those who have died before and those who are still here by the power of his Father and in agreement with his Father, God. We're still on verse 15, I believe, verse 15, it reads, "According to the Lord's word, we tell you, that we who are still alive. Now, Paul is not saying that he's going to be alive. He's not even saying that the recipients of this letter will be alive when Jesus comes back. But in essence, the idea as when the Lord comes back, there will be those here that have remained, those who are still in existence. There'll be those who died or who sleep in Jesus, and there will still be a population of folk here. But they will not precede those who have fallen asleep. That word, fallen asleep. Some people refer to it as died, others refer to it as sleep. But the idea is there will be a great getting up morning. And when Jesus comes back, the dead in Christ shall rise, and those who remain will be called up to meet him in the air. If sleep is more comfortable for you, then that's fine. If death, but to Jesus, death and sleep is just a thing that's overcome by him on Calvary. They will not precede those who have fallen asleep. Verse, or come before. For the Lord himself, verse 16 says, for the Lord himself will come down from heaven with a loud command, with the voice of the archangel and the trumpet call of God. For God himself will come down from heaven. We're looking for a destination of the presence of God. We look at this scripture, we see that is from heaven. And for the Lord himself will come down from heaven with a loud command, with the voice of the archangel. The Lord himself will come down in a loud command with the voice of the archangel. As it relates to the loud voice and with the trumpet call of God. Trumpets were used in during an antiquity in the military to call soldiers to active duty. Roman army, when the trumpet would sound three times, it meant that you, to the soldiers, and they heard the trumpet sound three times, you must get ready for war. Now, I tend to be a literalist. I think metaphors and these type of things are good and appropriate. But I tend to take the Bible in many cases and take it for what it said. So therefore, I believe that when Jesus returns, there's going to be a trumpet sound. And which indicates, festivals of God, theophanies, or various appearances, but there'll be a trumpet that's going to sound. And then the scripture says, the trumpet and the trumpet call of God, and the dead in Christ, those who know the Lord, but they're dead, they're asleep, will rise first, and the dead in Christ. It has the force of it happening immediately. You hear the trumpet, and then the rising of those who've gone on before. Verse 17 says they were caught up. After that, they were caught up. Those who are still alive and are left will be caught up together. In other words, swooped. It's going to happen immediately. The Lord comes back. The trumpet sound is not going to be enough time to run to the rocks and seek salvation, because it's going to be a caught upness, a swoopness. We who are still alive will be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord instantaneously. Trump sounds, it's a swooping. Therefore, we'll meet in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. I'm a literalist. I believe Trump sound, a caught upness, a swoopness, a swiftness, the rapture in the air. What a powerful visual. And then what does the scripture say? And we will be with the Lord forever. Wow. What a promise. We'll be with the Lord forever. How long is forever? I don't know, but it's for a long time. When all this happens in sequence, then we will be with the Lord forever. The Lord is coming back. We'll be with him forever. And then verse 18 lets us know, it says that, therefore, encourage one another. And this is a present imperative action. This is a strong word of encouragement, something that we should do, we should do, would be in order to do, to encourage. The church's responsibility is to encourage one another, even in death. With every tie, encourage one another. So those who were spending time being overcome, overtaxed with the resurrection or the annihilation of Christians, their brothers and sisters, and brothers and sisters in Christ, they're to be encouraged one another. Once you find out the truth, you use that to encourage yourself and to encourage others. There's a couple of points I want to mention, and then I'm going to do the benediction. Number one, to encourage yourselves, each other, with these words, the previous word passages that have been given. I think a few points can be pulled from this passage. Comfort one another, but also comfort one another with the words of God. I believe there's more comfort in the word of God than all of the comfort activities. And there's some good stuff out there. I have a book on good grief and discusses the stages of grief, grief feeling words, how to handle, what to expect in a major loss. Good book, it's called Good Grief. And it has scripture, because in my opinion, you can't write a book or any handbook without the foundation being on the Lord, on God's word. And then point two, I think this is a theological benefit from this passage, and that is Jesus will return. Jesus will return. He's coming. And it's going to happen quickly. We don't know the day nor the hour. But in these few sentences, for those who don't know, they will be able to arrive at the conclusion that Jesus will return, and his return will be purposeful to bring his own to be with himself. And we don't know when. Some religions have started based on them figuring out the stars, the moon, the sun, exactly when the Lord was going to come back. Some sold all their possessions because somebody told them that Jesus is coming back next week or a few weeks from now or 6 months from now. They figured out, and the Lord has validated for them that Jesus is returning for Christians, for his church, based on this sequence of events or formulas. But the Bible doesn't teach that. It teaches us that Jesus will return for his own, that we're just down here for a season. We're just pilgrims passing through. We have a time of death, and there's a dash in between them. And we have a time between birth, and death. God has allowed us a will and freedom to do with what we want with that time period, hopefully to follow him. But Jesus will return. So if there were any doubts, when this passage is read, it's more than about death and hereafter, but it's about Jesus will return. And then point three. We must remember that we don't know the hour or the minute the Lord will return. He will return. But the gospel isn't preached beyond the grave. It's not preached beyond the grave. So if you want to be among that number, years ago people used to sing the song, "When the Saints Come Marching In, I Want to Be in That Number." You can't depend on having a funeral and the preacher, pastor, whomever, preach you into heaven. You can't sell papal indulgences and someone pray you out of purgatory and into heaven to be with the Lord. One must make that choice now. The senior church used to say, "While you have a chance, while the blood is running warm in your vein." More graphic folk will use terms like, "Before your tongue cleave to your mouth." Oh, what a sight that would be. But before, while you're able, make that decision to make Jesus your choice. Because on the other side of the grave, there's no negotiation, no discussion, no regeneration. It is what it is. So we could take that whole package of ideas, teach from each other, teach to each other, and encourage each other. As the word of a singer in the 1970s, he's saying, "We're going to have a family reunion. We'll see loved ones who've gone before." And that's great, that's grand. I look forward to seeing family. Victory family, oh, some soldiers that we think about and that we miss. But our main goal is to see Jesus And the book of Revelation says, he will wipe away all tears from our eyes. The poet said it would always be Sunday. The month will always be May. What a time. What a time. What a time when all God's children get together. So there's hope. You find that you're being overcome by grief, or you're being stuck in a stage. Maybe it's denial. Maybe it's anger. Maybe it's bargaining. Whatever it may be. Some people say acceptance, and I'm not sure you ever really learn to accept the death of loved ones. You may learn to live with it, but I'm not sure you truly totally accept it. But others may believe that you can. But we look forward. We can love life down here, but we know that there is another life in the presence of the Lord. Yes, we're born dying. When we are born, there's a reservation at a cemetery. Edna Taylor used to say that we cannot cancel. So we're all on our way somewhere. Either you're on your way to be in the presence of the Lord, or you are going the opposite direction and to be in the presence of Satan and his workers and others who have rejected the message of the gospel of Jesus Christ. So we'll see you one day when all God's children get together. Somebody said, what a time, what a time, what a time. May God bless you, may he keep you. We hope that you continue to hold on to God's unchanging hands. And we pray that this ministry is a blessing to you. We continue to pray for those who are sick and shut in, for so many that are bereaved. And we're going to try to improve on our announcements where they actually will be written down for you to see. And we just thank God for Jesus and his many blessings. And the good news to share with you is next Monday, the abatement of the debris at Victory Baptist Church will begin to be removed. Ain't God good? Ain't God good? God bless you. Until we meet again. Thank you.
A few days ago, we had a family reunion. I was in South Carolina where I was born and raised, and we was coming up, and I brought some of my sisters, brothers, cousins. And you know what? We got to my sister's house. Prayer, and the Lord was there, and the Lord answered my prayer because it's good to do it sometime.
Oh, yes, it is.
And if all of us are together, we'll stand.
Oh,
your body will fall.
For Jesus.
If you haven't been home in a long time, would you promise me one thing? When you get a chance, would you do like we do?
Oh, yeah.
here's what you expect.